I think we need to make sure that people are really cautiously optimistic. Where we've gotten to in terms of where we are right now, which is a much better point in time than you and I last spoke, which is about a month ago, we're at a much better time. Our hospital numbers and most hospital numbers around the state are much better because of successful self-isolation and social distancing at home. And while the weather is getting warmer and people are sort of itching to get out, people want to be more involved. They want to, you know, be a little bit social. They want to see their friends. We've all been cooped up, but we still need to take everything that we did to get here seriously. We need to be, you know, watching very carefully on what's happening and be sort of aware at the first inkling of any signs or symptoms or potentially making sure that we're taking all the steps to prevent any type of surge activity.
How successful has this social distancing been?
I think it has been enormously successful. I really want to thank the folks that are watching this that have done a great job, our state and other states around the country. Social and physical distancing, isolation has definitely worked. You and I have talked about before, you know, what does this look like? We have to sort of think about how we live in a world where there still is COVID, where there isn't an effective vaccine and there are no effective treatments at this time. While you can have a sort of a gradual lifting and sort of seeing what happens, we're trying to go to some amount of normalcy, realizing that normal that we know now is going to be different. Realizing masks out in public, you know, restaurants coming into situations, screening, temperature screening, all those are going to be a part of sort of normal life right now. Social distancing has clearly been very, very effective. I think we just have to be mindful. If you're sick and you have symptoms, then you really need to stay home and avoid others.
How important are masks at this time, and what kind of a difference can they make?
We've learned a lot about COVID, and our understanding of COVID where it is now is different than where it was 6 or 7 weeks ago. Asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic shedding, transmission can definitely happen. And it's been estimated that 25% of the cases are related to asymptomatic transmission. So the mask is really helping you in that scenario. If you're out and you don't know that you may develop COVID, it's helping sort of protect so your secretions are not going out or are not putting others at risk. So I do think that wearing masks is important in many arenas where you're going to be around people and lots of people where there may be potential exposure, I think really important. Is it important when you're going out for a run and you're by yourself? You know, probably not as important. It's a bit hard to have kids wear masks. There may be a choking hazard if you're, you know, less than two. We do need to use some common sense, but I think it is going to be an important tool.
What's been your biggest frustration throughout this whole ordeal?
Well, probably the biggest frustration has revolved around testing. It's been frustrating. Where we were at the beginning of March was clearly at a time in this country where we didn't understand where COVID was. We had limited testing availability. Really, testing at that time had to be coordinated through the public health departments. They were put in a very difficult situation with limited testing and trying to steward those tests to really those that were critically ill. We did not have a great idea of how common COVID was and that it was actually spreading before we really could recognize it. Testing is much more widespread and available than it was, but it's still not where it needs to be. And part of ramping up and sort of gradually lifting things is having testing widely available. And if you want a test, being able to make sure that you can get a test. So we're not there yet. I think we are getting there and making sure that the states have resources to do so from a federal standpoint.
Does having COVID-19 prevent me from having a reinfection later?
Great question and a timely question. I think most of us feel that if you've had COVID and you've recovered from COVID, you're probably going to have some degree of immunity. How long that immunity lasts, how do we determine what that immunity is? I think we don't know at this point in time. But where we are right now, you know, at the end of April 2020, I don't think that we understand whether having antibody in your serum correlates to immunity. I think these are sort of unanswered questions. There are some reports from South Korea and China about maybe some patients possibly being reinfected. It's a bit unclear knowing what that means. We know that the molecular test, which is the most commonly used test right now, patients can shed virus, meaning that their molecular test can be positive for weeks on end, even when they may not exhibit any symptoms.
So many unknowns when we talk about herd immunity, antibodies, whether or not it will return in the fall.
All things that we just don't know. But what do we know? What can we rely on at least at this point?
Healthcare has been remarkably innovative, and really in an industry that's not always fast-paced, we've become very fast-paced. We've actually made changes literally overnight, and we've continued to evolve in the last 6 weeks. If we look at all the rapid changes and pivots that we performed, we should feel proud of that, that we've been able to adapt rapidly. And we're going to continue to rapidly evolve, putting in procedures and policies to make sure that patients are safe, healthcare workers are safe, to provide pre-procedural testing for all. I mean, these are things that we are sort of rapidly doing and accomplishing. One solace that I would take is that we have been rapidly gotten together and have sort of formed teams that are able to review what evidence we have, try to make evidence-based decisions as much as we can, and be humble enough to realize if we have done something that maybe doesn't make sense, to be able to sort of think about that and pivot and make a change and communicate that to not only to our patients, but to our staff. That makes me actually feel pretty optimistic about where we're going, cautiously optimistic.
What's the safest way
to lift restrictions and reopen the state again?
The way it's happening, a tiered strategy in terms of how we approach essential workers. And even when we think about sort of medical care, it's people that really need essential care right now, realizing that some of the things that we've learned now through this outbreak are going to continue. For example, virtual and telehealth, that's actually not going away. The reality is that is going to be much of the way medical care is performed. Not for all, but for many, it will be performed that way. The way we're thinking about making sure that testing is widely available, coming into the hospital or coming into the health system for any sort of care, continued screening and what those questions look like. And I think all those are needed. And in addition to thinking about masking, not just of healthcare workers, which we've been doing for, you know, a while now, but also masking for any type of patient that's coming in for care, which we've been doing as well.
As an infectious disease specialist, I trust your opinion
more than anybody else that I'm going to speak to. When do you think we might be back in stadiums again, whether it be for the Lions or the Tigers or the University of Michigan or whomever?
Those are still difficult to know. What happens with some of the gradual restrictions right now? And it, as you know, different states are doing different things. The experiment is already happening. How do states that are lifting things up very rapidly, as opposed to some that are lifting up gradually, what is the experience there in terms of, you know, COVID-related disease? This next 4 to 6 weeks are going to be really interesting to sort of see what happens. As far as large crowds and getting people together in stadiums, that's probably not going to be happening just yet. The reality is there's a significant part of the population which is still quite at risk for COVID-related disease and adverse outcomes from the infection. So we still have to figure out, you know, how we best protect them. We're probably looking at some time, and it may be, the reality is, for some of these larger sporting events until you have an effective vaccine or effective therapeutics available.
My selfish question.
I've only been able to see my mom now for 6 weeks through the window or 7 weeks through the window.
When might I be able to hold my mom's hand again?
Another difficult conversation, and just acknowledge sort of your experiences and the experiences of others that have sort of been through this. Also thinking about, you know, people that are even at the hospital and not being able to have visitors in. The reality is many of those patients are at higher risk because the ability for them to maintain social distancing from others or perform hand hygiene or having the staff with appropriate personal protective equipment is often limited. These facilities are trying to take steps as best as they can to mitigate risk. Until you know that there's effective therapy and effective vaccine, it seems unlikely that a lot of those restrictions can be lifted, because the potential exists for asymptomatic, unknowing carriage and risk to others. So St. Joseph Mercy Health System and Mercy Health as well have definitely partnered with public health, trying to offer universal testing at homeless shelters, at some of the skilled nursing facilities to better understand what's happening there, to also maybe enable these facilities to create processes and programs to treat for these patients that are minimally symptomatic.
Dr. Malani,
St. Joe and Mercy Health were among the first to treat COVID-19 patients with plasma from those who have recovered.
What do you think of those efforts?
I think it's been actually pretty remarkable. With convalescent plasma, what we need is the recovery of patients from COVID, and we need them to actually donate, go to the local blood bank, such as the Red Cross, give their plasma. And we've actually found just so many patients that have been diagnosed with COVID that want to help others. It's been an enormous outpouring of people that want to give back. We've actually learned quite a bit. We've been able to transfuse about 17 patients with convalescent plasma. So pretty remarkable. We are finding that the process for this is getting a bit easier.
When you look at the efforts that have been made, what's your hope?
The hope is that you get patients to do better with respect to COVID. And so we're giving this to people that are in the hospital. Traditionally, they either have severe or they're critically ill. We know that convalescent plasma has antibodies. We don't have enough donors at this time to give it to all patients. Anecdotally, we've seen previous experience with SARS and MERS and even Ebola, where there has been success with convalescent plasma. So right now, you know, there's probably thousands of patients across the country that are receiving this. And we're trying to kind of collate the data and collate the response and try to see if there's benefit.
Why were we so well suited
to try to help with this convalescent plasma?
We have a very active oncology research clinical trial group, a great community consortium of not only hospitals in our health system, but many other hospitals. They have proven over the years to do this work very, very high level and very, very successful. So we're actually able to leverage the expertise and leadership of that group to really quite rapidly design a process that could be used not only at our hospital, but throughout the Trinity Health System of 90 hospitals. There are some complexities figuring out who is a match. So there has to be a type and screen match. And there's also looking at charts to make sure that there's no adverse reactions related to the transfusion and getting that data back in a timely fashion. We've very much been blessed to have folks that know how to operationally do trial work to help these other hospitals get on board with this.
What's your hope and prayer right now?
We hope we can tell whether or not this is an effective therapy by learning whether this is successful, maybe that there are other avenues for this, whether it's hyperimmunoglobulin developing antibody or developing exposure prophylaxis for people that have maybe been exposed to COVID in a high-risk situation.
How are we doing at reopening the hospital and loosening restrictions at the hospital so people can come back and get the care they need?
Lots of patients that have delayed their care, whether it's whether it's surgery, whether it's procedures, whether it's diabetic related care, we need these patients to come back, making sure that everyone understands actually the hospital is going to be a very safe place to be. Not only are we screening all healthcare workers, all visitors with many questions, we're doing temperature screening. And before these procedures and surgeries, we are going to be testing everybody. Not only are we screening them for questions, but we're actually also testing them to make sure that they don't have any asymptomatic manifestations of COVID. We're going to be watching this very carefully and also watching what happens in the state as many places slowly begin to gradually unlift things and sort of how does COVID activity look like? How are we doing? And as a part of our design and our outreach, we're also, our criteria for testing, not just around procedures and surgeries, is really going to be a bit less stringent, meaning that if you need to get a test, we really want to try to get you a test.
Final question.
Where do you personally find the courage
to go into the eye of the storm?
So I chose infectious diseases, and I chose medicine because the opportunity was there to try to help people from a medical standpoint and to try to make them feel better. I think this, for many of us, really underscores that, and you're actually able to help people at a much broader level than just the individual patient, because we're talking about many thousands of patients. I don't know that it's something that sort of think about consciously. It's just something that we're doing. And this is the work that we do. And not just myself, but all the providers that are on the ground, they're doing this. And while there is definitely increased risk of saying you're providing care to COVID patients as opposed to not providing care, we are trying to take all the steps that we can to try to lower that risk by being experts in personal protective equipment, thinking about the issues of sort of staying home when you're not feeling well. I mean, this is a unprecedented time in our health system, in the country, in the world, just in humanity. We have to all try to chip in and make this better, and we all have a role to play. I don't see that there's really much of a choice there.
Dr. Malani, thanks for all you've been doing.
And I know you will continue to do.
Yeah, stay safe, okay?
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Lila.